أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. I'd just like to read a few ayahs from the Quran. The first ayah being from Surah Ali Imran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, "You are the best of people of all for mankind, enjoining what is right, forbidding what is wrong, and believing in Allah." And in the same surah, in ayat 104, he says, "Let there arise out of you a band of people, inviting to all that is good, enjoining what is right, and forbidding what is wrong. They are the ones who attain felicity." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in the Quran that if we enjoin goodness upon people, enjoin good and forbid evil, then we become the best of people. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in more than one place in the Quran to enjoin good and forbid evil. So we know it is a duty upon people. But unfortunately nowadays, we have tended to just become content at sitting down in our chairs, When we see our brothers, they're either drinking, or this, or they're moving away from the salat, or they're doing other haram things, we have no, we feel no desire to correct them. Because we think to ourselves, yes, we are contented. I am contented to sit at home. I pray 5 times a day. I pay my zakah. I fast. So what will happen to me? Nothing will happen to me. We turn a blind eye to these people who indulge in haram things, thinking that nothing will happen to us. But it's our duty, each and every Muslim's duty, to stop people from doing the haram and to invite them to goodness. This is everyone's duty. Now how do we stop them from doing bad? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us, if you see something improper, if you see something bad, then stop it with your hand. If not, then stop it with your tongue, say something against it. If not, then stop it in your heart and feel it in your heart that is wrong. If you just feel it in your heart, then you know that is the weakest of faith. But you should strive to correct it with your hand or your mouth. See, this principle of enjoining good and forbidding evil, we don't do nowadays. That's why people are treading over us in Palestine. That's why we're being trodden upon in Afghanistan. That's why we're being humiliated everywhere we look. There was once a time when the name Muslim was mentioned, and the kafirs, they would tremble, their hearts would tremble. And the other people, like the elders, and the weak people, they would feel good because they knew the Muslims were there to help them. That was once upon a time. This is because they had it in them to enjoin good and forbid evil. They knew to correct the bad and to enjoin the goodness. Now we're humiliated only because we don't enjoin good and forbid evil, because we turn a blind eye. And we just sit down in our chairs and be contented. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave us a parable. He gave us a story. And in that hadith, it said that, consider a ship. And on the ship, there was two groups of people. The people of the upper deck and the people of the lower deck. And the people of the lower deck, every time they had to go to the upper deck to collect some water, and every time they went to the upper deck, they caused inconvenience to the people on that deck. So they thought, why don't we drill a hole in the bottom of the deck so we don't have to go to the top? So they drilled a hole in the bottom of the deck. And as you can imagine, you know what happens when you drill a hole in the bottom of the ship? It sinks. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us that example to say, look, even though you may be the people of the upper deck, you may pray, you may fast, you may go to Hajj, you may go to Umrah, but if you don't stop people from doing wrong, if you don't speak against wrong, if you don't lift up your hand against doing wrong, then you may perish. You may sink just like the people of the boat sunk. But really, nowadays, we see people, we come and we listen to talks, and it goes in one ear and it comes out the other ear. Or we come to listen to talks only to pass the time. Or we come to listen to talks only to go away. That's the condition of the people nowadays. Because we're too scared. We don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. We know Islam. We know Islam, it wants peace. But peace under what? It wants peace under the Quran and Sunnah. That's the only way you're going to get peace. You're not going to get peace by just following the idealistic way, capitalistic way, communistic way. You won't get peace like that. You'll only get peace under the Quran and Sunnah. And we're talking about oppression. No one likes to be oppressed. No one likes to be trodden upon. But it's the Muslims that oppress themselves. We get oppressed from the kafirs, and even the Muslims, they oppress themselves. How do they oppress themselves? They do injustice to themselves. When amongst Muslims, amongst us, there are people who say you can't read the Quran and Sunnah. You can't read the Quran and Sunnah because it's too hard. Or you can never read the Quran and Sunnah to understand. That's how they oppress us. That's how we're oppressed. That's how injustice is created upon us. In the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the people, they used to quote this ayat. It's in the 5th surah, ayat 108. O you who believe, guard your own souls. If you follow right guidance, no hurt can come to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, guard your own souls. If you follow right guidance, no hurt can come to you from those who stray. And even now, people quote this ayat and say, look brother, the Quran tells you, if you follow right guidance, if you do good things, then no hurt can come to you. The people used to say this in the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. They used to quote the same ayat and the same excuse. This is the excuse they done so they didn't have to use their hands, so they can sit down and just turn a blind eye to their brothers and sisters. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, about this ayat, he said that I heard Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that if you see something improper, if you see something indecent, and you do not correct it, then surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down a punishment upon you. So there's people now, nowadays, they say to it, they proclaim that they want peace, they proclaim that they want justice. But in reality, it's them people that are causing the oppression to themselves. Because they do not lift up a hand when they see something going wrong. They do not lift up a hand to correct it. And then we are all punished for it. That is injustice. How unjust can you get? That is not being fair to anyone. But there's also people who will say, but no. If you go out, brother, if you go out and tell them harshly, then you will never invite them to Islam. You'll never be able to give them do tabligh properly, or you will never be able to do da'wah properly. But to enjoin good and forbid evil, there is a way. The way is that you do it. You do it with beautiful speech. You do it to bring them into Islam properly, without really scaring them. Because in Islam, we know that we only have two sources. We have the Quran and Sunnah. And really, in Islam, if you're going to do anything, it has to be done sincerely and it has to be done correctly. These are the two conditions that you have to work by. That it must be sincere and that it must be correct. Sincerity means that it's only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And correct means that it's only in accordance with the Quran and Sunnah. Because if you are going to invite people to Islam, or if you are going to propagate Islam, and you don't use this method, then you are doing more harm to Islam than you are doing good. You are doing more harm to Islam if you're not propagating Quran and Sunnah. You're doing more harm than good. I also like to quote another ayah to do with this. Ayah 71 of Surah 9. The believers, men and women, are protectors of one another. They enjoin what is just and forbid what is evil. Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us to enjoin good and forbid evil. It's not just to sit down, but to enjoin good and what is evil. We must never turn a blind eye. It's also related, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also related the incident of the Bani Israel, the Jews. And so many times in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts forward an example of the Jews, how they behaved and how blind eye and we do follow them. But the Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us an incident of the Jews. And that was that there was a group of Jews and they were doing things against their Sharia. And another Jew, he came and he said to them, what you are doing is wrong. What you are doing is haram. And he went away. The next day, that same Jew came to the same group of people. And this time, he didn't say anything at all. He sat down with them. Not only did he sit down, he ate, he drank, he socialized with them, he became friends with them. And he didn't say anything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he caused their hearts and his hearts to mingle so that he couldn't see the haram and that he started practicing the haram and that he didn't enjoin good and he didn't prohibit the evil and that he became one of them. And therefore, in the end, he and they were destroyed. That is the same condition that we're following nowadays. We know what is true, we know what is sahih. We know the best way. The best way is the way of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the best way. But no, we do not want to say it. We do not want to tell people this. We're shy or we do not want to hurt them. But in reality, you're only hurting yourself. Because we fear no one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, We have to tell people, we have to bring people into Islam in a just and fair manner. And as I said, we do not want to scare them. But this duty is incumbent upon each and every one of us. And we cannot give excuses as people do nowadays that I am not an alim. I do not know Quran and Sunnah. I am not a hafiz of the Quran. I'm not a muhaddith. But someone on this platform has already spoken that what knowledge you know, you must propagate it to everybody. What knowledge you know, you must propagate to each and every one. Every hadith that you know, every action of the Prophet you know, you should propagate it, but not keep it to yourself. So we really have no excuse. We have no excuse at all. We have to enjoin good, and we have to forbid the evil. And this is the only way that our society, that Islam, will always remain strong. Because without this function, our society, our Islam will deteriorate, just like the Christians and the Jews have deteriorated, because they did not practice this. And we are following them step by step, as was prophesied by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And yet we are still reluctant, and hesitant to get up out of our seats and to go and fulfill these duties upon us, thinking that we are in our homes and we're all comfortable and we're sitting lavishly. For the brothers that are just English speaking and brought up in this society, really all we are telling you to do, all everyone here is telling you to do, is just to follow the Quran and Sunnah. You can pick up the Quran and you can read it to the best of your ability. The Quran was meant for all of us. The Quran is a book of guidance. That is what we're asking the people to do, to read the Quran and the Hadith and act upon it, inshallah. And as regards that, I would just like to quote one ayah. This was the advice given by Luqman alayhi salam to his son. In Surah Luqman, Luqman alayhi salam says to his son, "O my son, establish regular prayers, enjoin what is just and forbid what is wrong. And bear with patience, constancy, whatever betides you, for this is firmness of purpose in the conduct of affairs." So Luqman alayhi salam tells his son to establish regular salah and enjoin what is just and forbid what is evil. This is the advice that he gives to his son, and this is the advice that we should be giving to each and every Muslim: to establish regular salat and to enjoin good and forbid the evil. All I want to say is that this is an important issue. You may sit there and just listen to me and just overlook this point. But I guarantee you, if each and every one of us overlooks this point of enjoining good and forbidding evil, if each and every one of us turns away from his duties, then it is not just that person that's going to suffer. It will be your brothers and your sisters that are suffering, just like they're suffering in various countries, in all parts of the world. Akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you very much, Brother Sarkhil. Allah Sarkhil min khayrat al-shabab ya'maluna fi majal al-da'wa wa huwa takallam hawla mawdu ahmiyat al-kitab wa sunnah wa qal anna hunaka darura li-ittiba' al-kitab wa sunnah an nafaham al-kitab wa sunnah wa la nastati an ننجا من هذه المشاكل حتى نرجع إلى الكتاب والسنة فكان خلاصة كلامه أهمية الكتاب والسنة خاصة وخاطب الشباب. Now I request Brother Abdullah Al-Farsi to come and deliver his speech. Brother Farsi, he is very famous study scholar in United States and very active man in Dawa work, and he came as a representative of Jamiat al-Quran wal-Hadith from USA. Brother Abdullah Al-Farsi.
Assalamu بسم الله، الحمد لله، وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. First of all, I would like to apologize for the brother and for myself because I am not even a student in Islam. I have spent most of my life studying engineering, which I wish I did otherwise. And the topic that the brothers requested from me to deliver concerning the proper way of da'wah. What is the proper way of da'wah? And the answer is very clear from the beginning, and that is the proper way of da'wah is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his great chosen companions whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have chosen by himself to accompany our beloved messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is not only the way of our Prophet, our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it is actually the way of all the messengers before him, all the prophets before him. As you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have sent so many messengers. According to a true hadith, 314 messengers. And the number of the prophets, more than 120,000 prophets have been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all those prophets and messengers were da'iyas to their people. They were da'iyas to the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only, and that is the religion of Islam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have said that this is the only religion, the Islam, which is to submit to the will and orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, both by heart and by limbs, both inherently and apparently. To submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by heart means to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most and to fear him the most and to wish and hope from him only, to depend upon him only, and to be sincere to him, to do whatever we do for the sake of his face only. And to submit by the limbs are the other aspects of Islam: prayer, zakat, siyam, hajj, tawaf, amr bil ma'ruf, nahi an munkar, jihad, birr al walidayn, silatul arham, and so forth. This is Islam, and this is the only religion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was no other religion but this. Now we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the universe, that he have ordered us to follow his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the easy way for us to gain success in the hereafter and in this life. And we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he gave us the order and the permission to give da'wah to his path, to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And peace and prayers be upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, the seal of the prophets, the last of the messengers sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the companions who have righteously followed him, followed his orders, followed his sunnah, his guidance, until the day of judgment. Dear brothers, we have to understand before we go into this matter the importance of da'wah. That da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the path of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself and the path of the messengers before him. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ. Say, this is my path. I call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala على بصيرة أنا ومن اتبعني. I call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to knowledge, me and all my followers. Therefore, he who does not want to share in making da'wah, he is not a follower of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he who does not want to do this da'wah in the right way, ala basira, according to the knowledge, the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he who does not want to follow this path, then he is not truly a follower of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The da'wah is the duty of all messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their followers to take people out of darknesses to the light, and from kufr to iman, and from shirk to tawheed, and from the hellfire to paradise. This is the da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a vague way. It is not a haphazard way. It is a clear way based on clear foundations mentioned in the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those foundations are so essential that if one of them is missed, then the da'wah will not be fruitful. Those foundations are so important, and as we see from the examples of those who are claiming the da'wah nowadays, the different groups, that those groups unfortunately miss one or two or three of those foundations, therefore they are going in circles. They are going in circles. They are not achieving what they should achieve had they followed the way that they should. Those foundations of da'wah are deeply rooted in the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we can briefly mention them. The first and most important foundation of da'wah is knowledge. The first and most important foundation of da'wah is knowledge. Ala basira. Basira means knowledge. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ. Say, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, this is my path. I call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on knowledge. And the one who gives da'wah will face situations where he needs the knowledge to clarify his points, to argue with others who might have a lot of points to mention. So how could he face those people? How could he face a Christian missionary who have memorized so many things that they have taught him against Islam? They have taught him that in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Jesus is Ruhullah. So this Christian missionary will come to the Muslim da'iyah, the so-called da'iyah, and face him with this. He will tell him, you are calling me to Islam while there is no difference between Islam and Christianity. We believe that Jesus is part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a'udhu billah, and you believe so also. It is in your book. Don't you read Quran? Of course, I read Quran. Didn't you read this verse? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Jesus is a soul from God. So that the so-called da'iyah will be shocked if he does not have the knowledge. He will be shocked. While the da'iyah who wants to call Christians to Islam, this is just an example. Because not every da'iyah necessarily is someone who calls Christians to Islam. He might be willing only to give da'wah to the Muslims, which is enough, alhamdulillah. There is enough ignorance and confusion amongst Muslims nowadays to devote our whole lives for them only. But this was just an example. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Isa is a soul from God, meaning that Isa is one of the souls that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have created. And another meaning is that Isa was created when Jibreel, whose name is the soul, blew into Maryam alayhi salam. And even Jibreel, when he called the soul of Allah, that is to honor him. Just like saying Naqatullah, Baytullah, the house of Allah in Mecca, it is to honor that house. It is not the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is not there, is living in the house. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above his throne. He is above everything. Neither this world, nor the heavens, nor any other creature can contain Allah Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Mu'an, I am going to send you to the people of the book. In other words, those people will have knowledge because they have a book. They have books. So you better be prepared. So that is the first fundamental in da'wah, the knowledge. Never say this is halal or haram, this is okay and this is not, without knowledge. And the knowledge is not what you think is right. The knowledge